Dr. Gerry Yokota, music in the classroom.
Okay, so good afternoon, everyone, and thanks for sticking around. I am here today to have some fun. I hope you'll enjoy some of the music I'm sharing, but also maybe something will resonate as I describe how my use of music in the classroom changed for the better as a result of the pandemic. And in a way that, you know, might be called a sort of a silver lining behind the cloud. So, but first, a little commiseration. I know we all had to deal with some tough transitions back in 2020, but I'd like to mention that I may have had a few more interesting twists than some. Not only was I shifting from face-to-face to online, but I was also moving away from having had all of my classes in call classrooms for the past 10 years. Because I semi-retired from my full-time position in March 2020, just as the pandemic was starting. I had been at the same national university for over 30 years, and I was just starting a new part-time position at a private university that April. Fortunately, I was familiar with the use of an LMS. I'd been using it also for about 10 years together with my call classes. But I did have a bit of difficulty switching from my anchor, which was the excellent WebCT Blackboard, to a sort of a no-brand Japanese knockoff with far more limited functions than Blackboard. I mean, it's not even anywhere near like Manaba or Moodle. But thank goodness, at least I was already familiar with Zoom, although using Zoom in the one hybrid class I had to teach did present some real challenges at first, where the support of the OTJ community was a lifesaver. But we survived, huh? And today I want to talk about how, for me, music played a huge part in surviving with some semblance of grace. So I'll talk today about how I first started using music basically to connect with my students through the computer screen, then how I went on to make it a weekly feature using songs that related to the textbook theme, which was the SDGs, then how I started making these music sessions into a weekly metaphor spotting game. I also use them as a chance to emphasize the importance of multilingualism and as a chance to introduce the concept of social activism. And finally, I'll be talking about how each of these situations fed into each other and enriched the process of establishing a system, far more than just randomly providing a sort of a casual entertaining break. But first, just to give you a little laugh as an icebreaker here, let me share a couple of my early failures. To be honest, at first, I desperately overreacted to the pandemic. It's not that much of an exaggeration to say that I went into full mommy mode thinking, oh my God, my kids are all gonna die, you know, and I'm never gonna see them again. And I kid you not, this is the first song I used to try to connect. If I die, let me die. Can everyone hear the sound there? Okay.
Just fine.
Okay.
Good.
Okay, thanks. And if that wasn't enough, there's more. Okay, Maroon 5, sung by a children's choir. so one more here.
Here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not, because the dreams bring back all the memories of everything we've been through.
Okay, but I quickly realized that was probably more than enough melodrama. So actually then I sort of bounced like a ping pong ball in the opposite direction, and it worked. It was obviously what they needed, especially after those first 2 weeks. So next, this is a song that actually got them to stand up and twirl their towels in the air like they were at a rock concert. So the first point I want to make here is, although I didn't realize it consciously at the time, it was my own personal connections that helped me make some of my most fortuitous music selections. Like if I had just done a Google search, you know, for COVID music, this song would probably never have made it through the maze of algorithms. It came to me because of my history with the anti-apartheid movement and actually having met the late great Miriam Makeba together with some other great South African icons. And it's Makeba who Kiju is channeling here in this variation of Makeba's original song, Pata Pata, which means touch, touch. So for the COVID era, no touch, touch, no pata pata. So it was around this time that I decided I really wanted to make this music session a regular weekly feature of my classes, not just an occasional break. So I desperately started searching for songs to fit the theme of the weekly lessons, which this semester were on the SDGs. So the next two songs relate to SDG 5, gender equality. Okay, first, Wannabe by the Spice Girls. Yo! Okay, but Wannabe, like the SDG itself, focuses mainly on cisgender girls and women, basically treating gender as a binary. So whenever I teach SDG 5, I always make sure to introduce a song that treats gender as a spectrum, as a non-binary concept, and speaks to the special needs of the LGBTQ plus community. So here's Lady Gaga in Japan, performing with a Japanese boy band, SMAP. Okay, so then moving along here, another song that was very popular was this song from The Greatest Showman. And I played this in connection with SDG 9 on reduced inequalities in a lesson on diversity, equity, and inclusion. But sadly, in a tragic twist of fate, that lesson came around the time of the George Floyd murder in late May 2020. But there again, I was blessed by another sort of life-changing encounter when I served as a marshal, a volunteer marshal in the Black Lives Matter demonstration in Osaka that June, which you can see there in the photo at the lower left. And there I had the good fortune to meet this amazing artist, Gordon Hippolyte, who recorded a cover of This Is Me with video footage from the Black Lives Matter demonstrations that were held around the world. And this video elicited a particularly deep response from my students. And it proved that Black Lives Matter is not just an American issue, it's a global issue. So this was another example, like No Pata Pata, about how my personal connections really enriched my music selection. And it was around this time that I realized that the website Playing for Change, which I think a lot of people may be familiar with, would no doubt be an excellent source of the kind of music I was looking for. Now, none of the songs I found there actually ended up making it into today's presentation, only the title. But I do highly recommend it. And here are just a few examples of familiar songs that you can find there. So clockwise from upper left there, you can see Cat Stevens, now known as Yusuf, singing Peace Train. And then you can see an ensemble of artists singing Marvin Gaye's What's Going On. And then another group singing Stevie Wonder's Higher Ground. And then finally, a performance of Bill Withers' Lean On Me. And I've used all of these in my classes. And I always share the lyrics of the song before showing the music video. And as part, around this time then, as part of the lesson, I started taking a little more time to give mini lectures about how metaphor promotes intercultural communication. And simply put, this is because people are always seeking to make sense of the unfamiliar, our new experiences, by drawing metaphorical connections with our own familiar life experiences. Okay, so here, for example, I use Pharrell Williams' Happy to introduce the concept of orientational metaphors, starting with up and down. When you're happy, you're up, right? Okay, and there you can see a couple of the lovely citizens of Osaka who cooperated in the Osaka version of this song. Once the students got the hang of the rules of the metaphor spotting game, of course, they immediately picked up on some of the other metaphors in songs like this. Like in Happy, there's the image of the hot air balloon. And I think you might have noticed some of the ones in the earlier songs I showed there too, like the beat of the drum, beating on the drum in the song from The Greatest Showman, for example. Okay, but of course, the opposite. When you're sad, you're down, okay? The other side of that orientational metaphor. And so in this case, I found that this metaphor of the landslide really resonated with a lot of students who had either heard about or some who had even experienced the triple disaster in Fukushima or had heard about it or about the great Hanshin earthquake, of course, also from members of their family or at school. Remember, I'm down here in Kansai, okay, in closer to Kobe. So this song, the original was by Stevie Nicks with Fleetwood Mac. Okay, it's an old 70s song, but it's been used over the decades in many different contexts. Some of you may know the movie One True Thing, for example, where Meryl Streep plays a mother who's dying of cancer and Renee Zellweger plays her daughter. So about how their life changes, you know, with the mother's terminal diagnosis. But the clip I want to share with you of this song today is a later cover by Robin Sherwood. And this is the one that was used in the movie Suffragette, which is shown here. So again, showing the huge change that was brought to the world with the movement for women's suffrage.
I take my love, take it down. Oh, climb the mountain and turn around. And if you see reflection in the snow covered hills, will the landslide bring it down? And if you see my reflection in the snow covered hills, will the landslide bring it down? Will the landslide bring it down?
And it was very helpful that the English translation for the international release of the popular Shinkai Makoto animated movie, Tenki no Ko, was the metaphorical weathering with you. And this brings me to another aspect of my educational philosophy that music helped me to reinforce, and that is multilingualism. So in the first class of the semester, you know, there's so many rules to remember. You can't blame students for going into cognitive overload and not being able to remember them all. I always emphasize the concept of multilingualism in my self-introduction on day one, telling them that their goal should not be to speak English with an American accent like me, okay, but rather to communicate with the majority of English speakers in the world for whom English is not the first language. So introducing songs by L2 speakers, I think, helps reinforce this point. And toward that aim, one band I frequently introduce is this one, One Ok Rock. And as you can see, this song uses a metaphor similar to the idea of the landslide when you're standing on the edge, so young and hopeless. Demons in your head, no ground beneath your feet. Colors in the dark. Okay, so not only being L2 speakers performing in English, but using a lot of these fascinating metaphors in their lyrics. I also like to introduce Utada Hikaru, and this song, Sanctuary, especially fits nicely into a lesson on refugees. And in this clip, you can hear her singing some of the lines backwards. And so the reason for that is she's trying to simulate the disoriented experience of a refugee who does not speak the language of the host country that they find themselves in. Okay, so finally, a note on social activism. Now, Mei-Joel and I just gave a joint presentation about this for a Kyoto Jolt event last weekend, so I'd like to refer you to that video that's up on the Kyoto Jolt YouTube channel if you're interested in more detail. But here, briefly, let me just promise you, okay, that I do not use the classroom as a soapbox to indoctrinate my students or force them to participate in any of my pet campaigns. However, I do believe that we all need to make an effort not to inadvertently contribute to an allergy to activism by making any reference to it taboo, as if any classroom can ever be neutral or non-political. So I say rather normalize the discourse by introducing it judiciously. For example, as part of a lesson on media literacy, where you remind your students that just because they found a piece of news, okay, in their social media feed or in their textbook, it may not necessarily be objective. So finally, here are just two examples I used in connection with SDG 15, Life on Land, and SDG 3, Health and Well-being. So the first one you see there by Paul McCartney is about animal testing. And then the second from Animals Australia is about factory farming with the voice of Babe the pig.
There's a place for us, somewhere a place for us. Peace and quiet and open air wait for us somewhere.
So that's just a small sampler of some songs that had a big impact on my teaching practice during the pandemic. Thanks for listening, and thank you all for sharing your ideas. And there are the links.
Thanks, Gerry.
Yeah, I have a quick one. I just want, like, how do you teach the metaphorical speech or the figures of speech?
How do I, well, I just, you know, I do it gradually. I mean, just in the first class, I just, when I introduce the lyrics to a song, I'll point out some of the sort of standard classic metaphors. I'll try to start out with some, you know, that are easy to understand, like fate is a roll of the dice or something like that. And then each week, as I introduce a new song, almost every song will have some kind of metaphor, and we'll just continue just getting used to them. And then I always have a class where I ask students to bring their own songs in, and they have metaphors in their own songs that they might not have been conscious of before.
I love that, like finding the metaphor. That's great. That's really cool.
I do have an article about that. I can maybe throw it in the chat eventually, that I gave it it's in the proceedings for a conference called Multicultural Japan, where I explained the metaphor spotting thing in more detail. Thanks.
Oh, yeah, I'd love that. Yeah, thanks. Please share.